Thank you. Gradually, as the mind becomes progressively spiritualized, withdrawn from sense activities, and by intelligence, the senses will be controlled. The mind, too, absorbed in material activities, can be engaged in the service of the personality of Godhead and become fixed in full transcendental consciousness. So the first process of spiritualizing the mind by mechanical chanting of the pranava omkar and by control of the breathing system pranayama is technically called the mystic of yogic process of pranayama, or fully controlling the breathing air. The ultimate state of this pranayama system is to be fixed in trance, technically called samadhi. But experience has proven that even the samadhi stage also fails to control the materially absorbed mind. For example, the great mystic Vishvamitra Muni, even in the stage of samadhi, became a victim of the senses and combined with the heavenly damsel, Menaka. History has already recorded this. The mind, although ceasing to think of sensual activities at present, remembers past sensual activities from the subconscious stages and thus disturbs one from 100% engagement in self-realization. Therefore, Shukadev Goswami recommends the next step of assured policy, namely to fix one's mind in the service of the personality of Godhead, Lord Sri Krishna. The Supreme Personality of Godhead also recommends this direct process in the Bhagavad Gita 6.47, beginning with Yoginam Apisarvisham. Thus, the mind being spiritually cleansed, one should at once engage himself in the transcendental loving service of the Lord, and by the different devotional activities, beginning with hearing, chanting, etc., if performed under proper guidance, that is the surest path of progress, even with a disturbed mind. Nyache trishaye vyokshan manasa buddhis sarati mana karma vir akshitam shubhate dharayetiya. Gradually, as the mind becomes progressively spiritualized, withdraw it from sense activities, and by intelligence the senses will be controlled. The mind, too, absorbed in material activities, can be engaged in the service of the personality of Godhead and becomes fixed in full transcendental consciousness. Om Agyatum Radyasya Pinam Chanam Salakyam Chakshurum Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namah. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Narayana Namaskritam, Naram Chalam Dharottamam, Devi Saraswati Vyasam Tatochayam Adhirahe. Astapreshu, Abhapreshu, Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya, Bhagavati Uthamish Bhakir, Bhakti Bhavati Nashriki. So, here we are again. Thank you for inviting me to the Sunday program here in Rijeka. Nice to see you all, or most of you. Last year I was here around the same time. The difference is last year it was after Ratha Yatra, this year before Ratha Yatra. Right? So I get the fortune that I can also participate next weekend. Saturday, is it now? Beginning what time? 5 o'clock? Yes. Like always, evening time, and the people coming out on the street. Then we go and have the Lord Jagannath, Baladev Subhadra, and the Sudarshan Chakra. Don't forget. We invite them on the chariot, and we'll have a nice celebration, a parade for their happiness. It's a festival for the happiness of the Supreme Lord. Normally we all have happiness, we want to have happiness for ourselves, for our own mental and sensual satisfaction. Therefore we go to parties, we go to nightclubs, like that, and have different kinds of meetings and singing, dancing and eating. And having a lot of fun. I know that. Fun is the main thing in life, you know, because if you don't have a happiness, relishing happiness or joy, we dry out. But people do, they mostly have to take intoxication to become happy, or do some kinds of nonsense for happiness. So Srila Prabhupada gave us the formula of happiness. And this formula is not something new, it is something that is given since long, long time, since thousands of years. It's not a speculation or somebody's opinion. It's a process of chanting the names of Krishna. And in this way, connect ourselves by Bhakti Yoga. Yoga means connecting, as we all know, with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that needs a process, and the process is given by the Spiritual Master. So Shukadev Goswami, he acted as the Spiritual Master of Parikshit Maharaj. So last year, I gave one class about Parikshit Maharaj in the 16th chapter, first canto, for those of you who remember, most probably not remember. So in that chapter, Maharaj Parikshit, he was checking or controlling the activities of Kali. Kali Yuga, personified, who came, in disguise of a king, and he introduced all kinds of sinful activities, or he wanted to introduce. Therefore he wanted to cut the legs of a dharma, of religion. Dharma, so that means honesty, cleanliness, truthfulness, cheating process. So he wanted to do his cheating process. Animal slaughtering. He wanted to open bottles and liquor shops. All this what is nowadays very common. No city. That city will be dead. City is dead. City is already dead now. because most of the people don't go shopping in the city, they go shopping in the shopping center, in the mall, not in the city. Therefore, every year more and more smaller shops they have to close. In the big markets, they're taking over, and they monopolize everything. So therefore, people have to have a car. They need some kind of vehicle, some infrastructure to visiting all these places of Kali, so that they can have enjoyment. But here, actually, Shukadev Goswami he recommends us a process of simple enjoyment, actually highest enjoyment. Enjoyment of the soul in relation to the Absolute Truth with Krishna, with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, through yoga. So he teaches the emperor dying, who was dying. He only had 7 days to live. We all have to die. So, but he had a fixed number of time to live, 7 days. That he knew. And therefore, when he met Shukadev Goswami, he asked him a question, you know, what should I think about? On what should I fix my mind before death? Or at the time of death, when the time is coming? And what should I think? What should I hear? What should I speak? And how should I act? And please also tell me, what should I not hear, what I should not think, what I should not speak, and how I should not act. So this is the fundamentalistic question of Maharaj Parikshit, on whose question the whole Bhagavatam theology or Bhagavat process is built up. It's the foundation. The foundation is on this simple question. What a man or a person has to do before dying? What should you do, what you should think, what you should hear, what you should meditate, what you should speak, and what you should not do, and how to act also, what you should do, what is the remedy. So Shukadev Goswami, already in the very first, actually Shukadev Goswami appears in the second canto. The first canto is more like an introduction to the scene of Shukadev Goswami is coming. Although first canto is already also important because it is giving us the essence, giving us the introduction of the whole Bhagavad philosophy. It is setting the scene of how Maharaj Parikshit, the descendant of the Kurus, the means of the Pandavas, retires from his kingdom because he got the news that he will die in 7 days, cursed by a Brahmana boy, and how the king was bold enough to give up his kingdom without resentment or regret, and went to the bank of the river Ganga or Yamuna, as it is known, and was waiting, was sitting there, not eating, not drinking, not sleeping. There were many sages around. So the first hand of this introduction is given, that Shukadev Goswami, the son of Vyasadeva, appears. He is the great authority of Bhagavatam, of the Bhagavata philosophy, or theology. So how he appears, he was only 16-year-old man, young man, beautifully looking, beautiful lotus eyes, smile, long, curly, blackish hair, bluish body, practically appearing like Krishna. He had all the signs of a Mahapurusha on his body, 32 symptoms of a great personality. So therefore he was very attractive also for women, and the children, they were running after him, had a happy time. But when they saw that Shukadev Goswami was completely detached from everything external and appeared in this great assembly of the sages. Maharaj Parikshit was fasting and waiting to meet the proper person who will give him the proper instruction and will answer him his question he had. So Shukadeva Goswami came there and he immediately everyone rise from their seat and offered respect. They all recognized him as a great personality, representative of Sri Vyasadeva. Maharaj Parikshit offered his obeisances and offered him a seat, Vyasasan, where the representative of Sri Vyasadeva will sit. And then he humbly approached the great sage, Self-realized personality, Shukadev, and asked him this question. Shukadev was very pleased about this question because he thought this question is the most important question to ask, not only for you, my dear king, but for everyone who lives in this material world, especially in the human form of life. I should ask this question, because everyone ultimately will face this time of death, and then who will help you? So Shukadeva Goswami tells, you maybe think your family will help you, or your grown-up son or daughters will help you, or the doctors of your country will help you, or your government will help you in that time, or the police. No. The news is, or the old news is, the message is, nobody of them can help you. Because they're all failable soldiers. Saimizu asatsyopi. Tesham pramata nidhanam pasyamati apashyati. So, because they're themselves drowning in the ocean of burning death. So, how they can help? But they don't see their ultimate destruction. Problem facing them, although they're facing so many problems. But mad as they are, illusion by Maya, they keep going with their lifestyle, not realizing the great, great problem and trouble what they will face in one time in the future. So Shukadev Goswami, he prepared the king on that, to fix his mind on the absolute truth, Lord Sri Krishna, on the Supreme Person, the Supreme Object of Meditation. So Krishna is the Supreme Object of Meditation, because he is Parama, Ishvara Parama Krishna, Sachitananda Vigraha, Anadya Adya Govinda, Sarvakarana Karana. So Krishna is above this material existence. He has not a material body, he's eternal. And we are also eternal, and we have a material body, but the soul is encaged in this material body. And to come out of it, we need help. We need the help of the spiritual master. So by good fortune, we meet Shri Master, who gives us the information about the goal, our position, and our relationship in that goal, Supreme Object, Lovable Object, Sri Krishna, and also the way how to go there. So he gives us the sadhana and the sadhya. This is very important. If somebody maybe is very intelligent, but if he doesn't know, but he doesn't know how to, the sadhana and the sadhya, then what is the use? Like Sanatana Goswami, when he approached Lord Chaitanya in Varanasi, Benares, so he, with a humble mood, he offered his obeisances to Lord Chaitanya, and who is the Supreme Lord, great scholar. I know so much, but actually I'm grateful because I don't know what is sadhana and what is sadhya. I don't know who I am, Because when I don't know who I am, then how I know what is the goal? And what is the sadhana, the activities to perform to achieve that goal? Therefore, my dear Lord, please instruct me. So that's the beginning of disciple. Disciple means to have this fundamental understanding about our position, that I'm ignorant, I'm fool, and I'm approaching the knowing person to ask questions, relevant questions, and self-realized spiritual master, like Shukadev Goswami or his representative, can give perfect answer. Disciple has to be very curious, very sincere. Spiritual master has to be sincere and authoritative. He cannot be a speculator. So when these two combine, very good result will appear. Krishna will appear. So Shukadev Goswami, he encouraged first of all to make the Maharaj Parikshit the first step to understand what is material, what is temporary, and what is spiritual, what we should actually meditate about. So first he explained him about the universal form. How to meditate about the universal form of the Lord. Actually, this material universe is nothing is separated from Krishna, because everything is his energy and he's everywhere. From the lowest planetary system up to the top, in all heavenly directions, everything the Lord knows and is present there and represents him. So Shukadev Goswami, he encourages Maharaj Parikshit to fix his mind first on the universal form and then ultimately on the super soul in the heart, and later on, of course, also on Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Super soul, of whom super soul and Brahman and his universal form are just his expansions, or expansions of expansions. So therefore he explained to him the yoga process. Maharaj Parikshit, because Maharaj Parikshit asked, what should I do? What should I think about? About what should I meditate? So Shukadev Goswami, he first wanted to tell him that to meditate about Krishna is not difficult, because his whole universe is actually not different from Krishna. So therefore, if you see everything in yoga or in relationship with Krishna, then this universe will be not an entanglement, it will help you to deliver you and become free from the bodily conception or of the repetition of cycle of birth and death, and you will become liberated. Although not liberated in the Goloka or in the Vaikuntha, in the spiritual world, but you will go to Brahman. Because sometimes some yogis are just happy to become liberated in Brahman, in the Brahmajyoti, in the divine light. That's what they want to achieve. So Shukadev Goswami, he first mentioned, therefore, this universe, description about this universal form, how to meditate about that and see how everything is related to Krishna. The sun, the moon, the stars, the heavenly directions, the elements, water, air, fire, ether, like that, the mind, intelligence, everything is represented by the Supreme Lord. It's his energy. Because if you don't see in this material world how everything actually has a connection already from the, still on the material platform with the Lord, it's very difficult to become a devotee of the Lord and devote yourself to Him. Especially for the general mass of people, impossible, because they have mostly tendency to see material objects. But Bhagavatam, material objects or the contemplation of material objects has no place in Bhagavatam, because that's material, it's illusory. It will entangle you in the cycle of birth and death. So Shukadeva Goswami, he gives us first an idea. It's an idea, a meditation, how to fix the mind on the universal form of the Lord, so that we can learn how to see everything in relation with Krishna, not to our own sense gratification. The same principle actually is introduced by Srila Prabhupada and our acharyas, who tell us, you know, how to fix our mind on Krishna. So either in the universal form or in super soul in the heart. Although these two processes are rather more difficult to complete, because they are mechanical, it depends on your mind and the intelligence. Because this meditation about universal form and the meditation about the super soul in the heart is a mechanical process, also known as Ashtanga Yoga. So one learns in this way, in a mechanical way, to fix the mind with the help of the intelligence on this universal form, to fix the mind and the idea that actually everything is in relation with Krishna, so that the mind will become peaceful. That's the ultimate thing. That the mind first, because the mind is troubled by the material energy, by tamas and rajas, it's covered and dragged down, and like on waves in the ocean, sometimes up and down. The mind is like a wild horse, driving you in different directions. So the yogi has to absorb. Krishna in the 11th canto describes to Uddhava how the yogi has to observe in the beginning what are actually his mind, in which direction, what actually is the tendency of his mind. So one has to meditating or seeing what is actually the mind, in which direction the mind is actually dragging you, what is his tendency. And this tendency is what the mind has, you know, it's not something what you teach him, it's something, a program what he actually got since many, many lifetimes. It's impressions in the subconsciousness. Prabhupada is pointing it out in the purport. It's impressions of unconsciousness, what carries us from one body to another, from life to life. And that forces us to act in a certain way, without thinking, without control of ourselves. We have our senses, our mind, not under control, because it has a nature. The mind has nature, and it drives in a certain direction, like a wild horse. Therefore, Krishna says one has to observe the horse. What is his tendency? And then with the rein of mind and intelligence, you know, we have to learn to control the horse. Or like a dog. You give sometimes a dog a free line, you know, now he can do whatever you like, but in one punch, you bring him under control. You train him. So this training or this needs discipline. And this discipline, it's called sadhana. Sadhana means following guidelines given by the guru and by the scriptures. And if you follow these guidelines of the scriptures and of the guru, then we can learn. He has 5 senses, actually 10, with the active senses, arms and legs and genital, like that. it's 11 senses in total with the mind. So the mind is the central sense. So and if you can fix the mind on Krishna, giving him a higher taste in Krishna consciousness, then he will become happy, because the mind wants to become happy. But because he has habits since many, many lifetimes of karma impressions, very deep in the subconsciousness, therefore the mind actually doesn't know anymore that actually is real happiness. Therefore he is satisfied with some happiness that he receives according to his body, what he has now. And because he is habited to this kind of habit or activity, he goes on like that. And so in this way degrades himself, life after life, becoming attached to this material world, to these objects of material sense gratification, in a lower, higher way or lower way, or sometimes both, and engages in certain activities. What forces you to again accept the new body in the next life? And you take the program again with you from this life to the next. I mean, as long the mind has impressions from this life or another life, and this is not eradicated or deleted, it has to take a new body again and again, either in Sattva Guna, Raja Guna, or Tama Guna, or a mixture of them. So through the Bhagavatam school, Srimad Bhagavatam teaches us, you know, how to purify our mind from our karma impressions. Not only from our external thoughts, but from our nature, but we have who drives us or forces us, even without our willing, to act in a certain way. As Arjuna is telling to Krishna, after Krishna explained him the yoga process in the sixth chapter, so Arjuna thought, oh Krishna, this is for me very, very difficult to focus or fix the mind in yoga, in dharana, dhyana, to go to samadhi. It's very difficult. For me, I'm a kshatriya, I'm a warrior, and for me it's very difficult to control the mind. I'm not a trained yogi. It's more difficult. It seems to me that the mind is more difficult to control than the wind. Who can control the wind? Especially here on the Adria. Certain places, wind very strong. Certain days. Who can control him? Nobody. We have so much advanced technology nowadays, but they cannot control the wind. They cannot control the earthquakes. They cannot control the nature of the material energy. Because this material energy is very, very difficult to overcome. It's very, very difficult. Krishna says, yes, my dear Arjuna, I agree with you. It is very difficult to fix the mind in yoga praxis. But I tell you, by regular praxis, by sadhana, if you know sadhana, a guru, even by guru and scriptures, and you follow that regularly and make this as a habit, then you ultimately can conquer the mind by practice, by determination. And you are a kshatriya, you are very determined. Your nature is determination. Everyone has determination 110% if it is for your interest. Nobody is lenient or I'm weak, I don't have determination. Everyone has, if your mind and the senses like it. You go heart attack, you go crazy for it. And for everyone is somehow or other 100% determined for something, but not for Krishna. That's the problem. And that we have to learn, you know, how to fix our mind on Krishna. Savai mana Krishna padara indayo. Vachamsi vaikunta gunana vanane. Yoga means to fix the mind on Krishna's lotus feet. jnana vastita tatkatena manasa pasyanti yam yogina. Yoga means to fix the mind on lotus feet of Krishna, because it's the supreme object of all yogis. And as long as we don't fix the mind on Krishna, but on impersonal meditation, we will fail, because it's mechanical. Like Prabhupada gave the example of Vishwamitra Muni. That's just a history of long time ago, of yours, of time ago, yugas ago. In yuga where the people were living 1,000 years, or 10,000 years, or 100,000 years. That was the time. Now we get bluffed, you know, by the propaganda, modern propaganda. Actually, people get older nowadays. No, it's foolishness. A lifetime Kali Yuga is shorter than in other ages. Maybe in comparison with medieval age, it's longer. 500, 1,000 years ago. But what happens 100,000, millions of years ago, there were also humans who were actually much more elevated spiritually in the conception of the harmony of universe and of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That actually our people today are considered, in comparison to them, complete fools, idiots. Because we only see make ourselves completely dependent on the material technique and bodily conception of life, whatever this modern age is facilitating us. And now we think this is all in all. And therefore, we have to go to work for that to become happy. If I have this, I will become happy. If I will have that, and I will become happy. If I will have this, I will be happy. But there's no happiness by just giving gratification of the gross material objects, because they're not giving happiness. So Vishwamitra Muni, who lived in another yuga, he had 100,000 years to live. Nowadays, we have maximum 100 years to live, but he lived 1,000 times more than people who live, a lucky person who can live 100 years today, and he could live. Because it was in Satya Yuga. But still, although he could meditate and fix his mind in trance, in complete absorption, in the super soul, after 70,000 years of meditation, he became attracted to the ankle bells, of the ringing ankle bells of the heavenly damsel. Menaka. No wonder. Who is Menaka? Menaka is the Lord's energy. It's an internal... You have to understand Menaka's history. Menaka's history, she appeared from Naranarayana Rishi. Urvasi. But it was the same. Menaka also, great, 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 beautiful, heavenly damsel, Apsara. So this Apsara, when this yogi heard her, the sound, he came out of trance, opened the eyes, saw this beautiful young lady, because although these ladies are very, very old, they still always look young in the heavenly planets. So he immediately felt attraction. So he wanted to have a relationship with her. She also felt attraction to him, because women mostly become attracted, not to Grihasthas, because the Grihasthas are already married, but they become attracted to renunciates, to sannyasis, or yogis who are renounced. The woman becomes very much attracted, because that's for them something very interesting. It's very something, how I can have a love with this person. So therefore, many women sometimes run after the renounced personalities. They don't run after Grihasthas. Actually, Grihasthas are protected by the wife. Further, deeper absorption in samadhi. So that means he is only a he has only a city. That means he has city powers. But that's not the goal of life, to attain city power. So the goal of life is to stop the cycle of birth and death and go to Krishna and become an eternal associate of him. So he wanted to become a yogi, a brahmana, and for that he performed many, many long austerities and penances and yoga exercises, and felt attraction to this lady. So again, another 10,000 years he had to meditate to recover, to build up again this lost, fall down. It took him a long time again. And then ultimately became recognized as a great yogi, but not as a great devotee. No, that's the difference. He didn't become known as a great devotee. So here the example is given, Vishwamitra Muni, the great yogi. Although he was a great yogi, he had so much difficulty. He struggled so much with his senses and with his mind, and with his desire to become recognized all over the universe by the great Maharishis and Brahmarishis, great kings of yogis, so become recognized by them. So that was his drive, that was his ego. He had such a strong Kshatriya ego that he wanted also to achieve this recognition, and therefore ultimately, if you follow yoga as a kind of sense gratification, that you become famous and recognized and get some cities and some kind of powers, then you maybe get it, but you cannot make further progress and in direction love to Krishna, the supreme object. So the yoga process in itself, mechanical yoga process, just to fix the mind on Super Soul or Paramatma, is mechanical, and it's difficult to achieve, as Krishna says, also in the 12th chapter. It's difficult. There are two processes. One is mechanical, the meditation about the impersonal. And universal form is, in one sense, also impersonal, although it's a meditation about the universe, but it's some idea, an imagination of the mind with the help of intelligence to understand that universe in relation with the Supreme Brahman, the Supreme Lord. But it's very difficult to attain a personal conception with that. But still, Shukadeva Goswami recommends that path, going through this procedure, so that we can ultimately understand the material world is not something separated, just for our sense gratification. It's not just for that. It's a place where we can train our mind and the senses to engage this material energy in the service of the Lord. And this is the ultimate yoga. So the mind and the senses, they have tendency to enjoy, as described in the beginning. But they're forced by the material energy, by the gunas. So to come free of these gunas, we have to learn how to fix the mind on transcendental sense gratification in relation with the Supreme Personality of God and become attracted to this form, this transcendental form, Shyamasundara. Because if the mind becomes attracted to the beautiful form of Krishna, then you can give up attachments to the material, temporary forms. You cannot give up attraction to form, quality, activities, smell, taste, sound. It's very powerful. And it's like, anyway, energy of Krishna. So we have to learn how to engage with sound and the form and the taste in yoga. That's what we learn in Krishna consciousness, how to engage in a sadhana, where we can engage all our senses with the mind together to engage it in Krishna's activities. That's actually very simple. Everyone likes to eat, okay, eat Krishna prasada, food offered to Krishna. Everyone likes to hear beautiful sound, okay, hear Hare Krishna Maha Mantra or songs about Krishna. That's the original sound, Brahma Shabda. So fix your mind on the transcendental sound. If you like to see beautiful form, take darshan and contemplate Krishna's beautiful form, how he is dressed, how he is decorated. And if you become overpowered by this beautiful meditation, then you can forget the temporary attachments to the material forms and taste and smell and like that. So we all like to feel, we like to touch, we like to smell, we like to taste. So all this is supplied in Krishna consciousness, in yoga, bhakti yoga. And that we learn. And if we engage this in daily sadhana, fixed on Sadhya, the Supreme Lord Krishna, then we will develop more positive attachment so that we can give up the lower things. Like the history of Lord Jagannath, because you know that there was the formerly one king, Indradyumna, he had a desire to also see the Lord. He was not satisfied with the impersonal meditation. He wanted to see the Lord, eye to eye. He wanted to serve Him. The universal form, there's no seva. It's a neutral meditation. Even in Paramatma, there's only little seva. Little, but mostly also neutral. With the service attitude. So therefore, if it only in Bhakti Yoga, if we serve the Transcendental Lord in the deity form, Archa Vigraha, then actually we can engage all our senses in the most perfect way. Like Srila Prabhupada, maybe we ask, you know, where actually the movement started? In New York or in Los Angeles? Prabhupada told, actually it started in Los Angeles. Because in New York was just an experiment to chant Hare Krishna. There was no temple, there was no deity worship. You only teach the hippies there how to chant Hare Krishna by his own example. He showed them everything, A, B, C, how to clasp, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So that they also get the rhythm. And the Hare Krishna, very simple melody of Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. He was cooking for them, cleaning for them, and he went with them to the Tompkins Square Park, in New York, this one park, big park, where they had some. He went to Sankirtan in the park. There were many Ukrainians, Puerto Ricans, and black people and hippies and people who were there just lying around having many, many dogs. And Prabhupada, he went to that park with his devotees about bongo and some improvisation, some carpels, simple carpels there. And then there was this Allen Ginsberg. You know, he was the big poet amongst the Beat time there in that time. So he came and he also joined them because he had Indian experience in the early 60s. And then Allen Ginsberg, because he was very famous, then a newspaper came from New York. They wanted to interview him. And then Allen Ginsberg told them, you should not interrupt a man who is doing worship and prayers. So he refused to interview them. So that was the time when Prabhupada, for 2-3 hours, you know, that he was chanting, sitting, and these young fellows, these devotees, mostly not shaven, only one devotee was shaved in that time, all others had long hair with beard, and they were chanting Hare Krishna. So Prabhupada's secret formula was, give them chant, because everyone at that time became crazy for music. So he gave them chant and he gave them prasad. Because everyone liked to eat something, but instead of eating nonsense food, you know, or some macrobiotic food, you know, he gave them Krishna prasad. So this way he made them completely attached. They become completely attached to his personality. As Swamiji, as they addressed him. And they followed completely everything like a son attached to the father who is taking care for them, you know, he was following them. But then Prabhupada got an invitation in another go to Los Angeles. And in Los Angeles, the first devotees there, they required an already in a temple. And the temple was an old church. An old church. But they changed in the temple. Because people lost interest in rituals. Why people don't go to church anymore? Because they lose interest in rituals. But Prabhupada, he brought life. He brought something very practical for the devotees, for the searching people at that time, mostly young people. How to chant, how to dance for Krishna, how to be happy in Krishna consciousness, and how to take proper prasada food offered to Krishna. But then when the devotees found this temple in Los Angeles and the first temple was opened, then Prabhupada installed the first deities there. Deity worship was introduced. Therefore, Prabhupada told actually the Hare Krishna movement didn't start in New York, it started in Los Angeles, because a movement or an institution or a movement needs a center of education where the devotees can come and learn how to worship the deity, how to learn how to cook, how to dress the deity, how to go and preach and spread the Krishna conscious process. The philosophy is learned. And for you see in India, there are so many temples. So a temple is therefore very much needed. It's a mother center. It's a place where one finds shelter. People nowadays lose interest in a temple or church. You know, they go out in the... They stay at home and watch the TV. Futomach. Other boring programs. Or they go out in the forest, you know, or in a park. For them, that's for them God. Nowadays, what is God for the people? You know, a religion, it's football. Or the nature is religion. It's okay, you know. But ultimately, everyone becomes very political, very frustrated, because it's only agitating. Agitating the mind and the senses, and you take side. But in yoga, you cannot make side. It cannot be politic. I'm for this and that, against that. That's what we try to overcome. But that's not very favorable, religion, you know, football religion. or going out in the nature. It's even maybe better, you know. At least the mind can become a little peaceful, you know. Maybe have some good thought, you know. But if you only think, if you go out in nature and smoke a cigarette there, go there and have some relationship with your girlfriend, you know, then the nature is not that what the nature is. The nature previously was a place where the yogis found a shelter, you know, to meditate. But this is not fine anymore. In Kali Yuga, therefore temple is needed. Where people can learn, you know, how to actually have not just a boring program or a boring ritual, but nobody understands, but something that actually gives relishment, that gives enjoyment to the soul, gives enjoyment to the mind, and to the senses even. That makes the temple then, or people coming, and they become attracted to it. People like festivals, people like also Rath Yatra or Harinam. They should be organized in a very attractive way so that people become attracted. I think we spoke about this last time, no? That if you go on Harinam and just in a very lousy way, not properly dressed, not even a devotee dress, and no tilak, no harmony, no organization of the Harinam, you know, everyone spacing out, then this is not attractive. So the devotees should make this program attractive, so that then people will become attractive. If the devotees, if they see happy people, happy and pure, and even if they're special dressed, so it's a problem. First, when they saw Prabhupada, you know, Buddha is coming. So Buddha, they called him Buddha, you know. Like make all kinds of sounds, you know, but like they're called, it looks a little aborigine and exotic. So, but doesn't matter, you know. Ultimately, the people become attracted if the program is nicely presented. And the devotees are happy and joyful, and offering them nice prasad and nice music and chant. Then they become very happy. And that's what actually Prabhupada wanted, that these festivals and also the temple is so nicely and enlivenly organized so that many, many people will become attracted. Because they're looking for some kind of enjoyment. They look for this kind of enjoyment. And but they don't know the address. Not the place. Therefore, this preaching is very important. Going out and Harinam, but not just two, three, or in an unorganized way, but in a very organized way. And this is what Prabhupada wanted. And they should be trained. You know. And also, the devotees who come to the Sunday feast or to the temple, they should be properly dressed, in devotional dress. Do not come with your karmic dress. Therefore, every temple has a garderobe. Garderobe, and you can take your sari and your dhoti with you, and you dress yourself there, changing your dress. So that the people also will know us as the Hare Krishnas, you know, in our traditional dress. Do not dress ourselves with our usual dress, especially in the temple. Therefore, Prabhupada, he made the temple, he wanted to have the temples organized in such a way that the persons who come here, they learn how to live like devotee. He didn't like that devotees had long hair or, with jeans and t-shirt in the temple, or even short pants and like that. At home you can do that, you know, but in temple, that's your private place. But in temple, you go in the proper clothes. Like if you go to the church, you cannot go lousy. So you go with the proper dress. And then if everyone is properly dressed, then that already arises the same. So we have to engage our mind, our senses, our body. Senses means body. In Krishna service, that's the easy process for this age. This universal form meditation or Paramatma meditation was actually for an other time. It's not actually for today's time. Especially not in the Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition. We have immediately got this mercy because that's a reform program. Like in Christianity, there was also the reform program by Jesus, you know. Before it was also very ritualistic, everything very complicated in the Old Testament. But then Jesus came and he gave more the mercy also. So actually Krishna or Lord Chaitanya came 500 years ago to give this great mercy, even a greater mercy that Jesus gave. Because Jesus only liberated those who became his followers. But Lord Chaitanya delivered everyone through the Sankirtan, the moving and the non-moving, living entities, by the chanting of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. And Srila Prabhupada, you know, as pure representative of Lord Chaitanya, he introduced the same process or method of Sankirtan like Lord Chaitanya did 500 years ago. He didn't invent something new. Lord Chaitanya was chanting, dancing, taking prasadam, inspiring so many people by his ecstasy, devotional ecstasy. His followers, the six Goswamis, were chanting, dancing, taking prasadam, associating with each other, having complete ecstasy. So many became attracted to them. Prabhupada did the same. One time they asked Prabhupada, what is the difference? Actually, Prabhupada thought, what is the difference between me and the Goswamis, six Goswamis? They were chanting Hare Krishna, I chanting Hare Krishna. They were writing books, I'm writing books. They're associating with each other, I'm associating. I take prasadam, they take prasadam. There's one difference. They are living every night underneath another tree. And I live every other night in another palace, in a temple. That's the difference. But the process is the same. It's not the place that makes a difference. It's the consciousness. Therefore, you can be in Vrindavan with Maya consciousness and not be in Vrindavan. And you can be 10,000 kilometers away from Vrindavan and be in Vrindavan or Krishna consciousness, and you are in Vrindavan. Because Vrindavan is there where there is the consciousness, Vrindavan consciousness. Radha Krishna, Krishna Balaram, cowherd boys, the gopas. Therefore Prabhupada was singing, he introduced his song, Jai Radha Madhava, Unja Vihari. He thought this is a picture, this is a showcase in the spiritual world, in the Goloka Vrindavan. So by meditating about this Jai Radha Madhava, Unja Vihari, Gopi Chana Lalava, Girivaradhari, you get all the activities that is going on in the spiritual Vrindavan, here in this material world, who is present here in this material world. Same activity, you get a glimpse in it. The Acharya, Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives us the glimpse, he gives us the mercy to have a glimpse in the real Vrindavan. You go to Vrindavan today, not with the glimpse or with the open eyes of the Acharya, you see only dirt, polluted water, garbage everywhere, corruption, people who are going to take something from you, pollution, a lot of noise, a lot of monkeys and dogs, like that. And drink share all this. But if you have the Vrindavan experience or the Vrindavan spirit and the vision, then all these things, you know, this is just Maya acts. Not a problem. You have a problem. because Krishna is still there, the temples are there, the Yamuna is still there. Even if it's a drop of Yamuna there, the Yamuna is there. And even if the real Yamuna water is not there, Yamuna is still there. Like Krishna never leaves Vrindavan, Yamuna never leaves. Govardhan never goes, Vrindavan never goes. And the deities are, although the deities left in different places in Rajasthan, due to attack of the Muslims, want to destroy the Murtis there, or deities. So they still, these deities are now there, the Pratibhu, yeah, Krishna, Radha is there. So, and you get so many devotees there. And especially at Krishna Balaram Mandir there, at Radha Shyamasundar, the most beautiful deities, Krishna Balaram, Purnikai, Sila Prabhupada Samadhi. And if you go with this spirit there, you know, to associate with devotees and with the Vrindavan, Krishna conscious spirit, you live in Vrindavan. And you can take the same spirit also outside of Vrindavan and live in Vrindavan. But still it is important to also visit Vrindavan, because to visit Vrindavan means charging up our batteries to get more inspired, reminded about this Vrindavan. And then if you come back, you know, everything that reminds you about Vrindavan immediately drags your mind there, to go there. Very natural. Like if you hear a certain sound vibration from previous time, what you liked previously, and you were not devoting, immediately your mind goes there. You forget everything else. In 1 second. It's not a question of time. Mind is so fast. Immediately the old impulse, the old attraction and the impression is immediately there in this melody. And you have the full melody, full in your mind. Not only the melody, even the taste, and the smell, and everything that was connected from that time with the melody is there. And that's a material example. So therefore, if you hear a Prabhupada chant, or a Vrindavan chant, or a Vrindavan melody, or a message from Vrindavan, no, immediately all your senses are like the smell, the incense there. Even the bidis remind you about Krishna. And all these betel nuts, you know, what the people eating there, you know. That smell reminds you about Krishna or about Vrindavan. The incense, the ghee lamps. The sound, the form, all the atmosphere there, the devotees, the media there. So powerful these impressions to mind, especially through sound. Sound is very powerful. Sound is the beginning of life in this material world. Chapter. Everything comes from sound. So this material world was created by sound. So sound is very powerful. So we come in this material world through sound, and we can also come out of this material world through sound. But it has to be transcendental, not material sound. So therefore, if we come in contact with the original sound, Krishna mantra or Om, or better than Om, what is a meditation mantra, is Hare Krishna mantra. Names of Krishna, and immediately this reconnects you with Krishna, with our original root. Because we are all eternally Nitya Siddha Krishna Prem. We are eternally related to Krishna. What have forgotten? But the sooner we come in contact with this transcendental sound from Bhagavatam, from the holy name, in the association of devotees, who have this experience and all this, then we will immediately become reminded and we live in that place. So therefore, Krishna consciousness is in a joyful way, not even because I must now, or out of fear, In the beginning, maybe this drive of fear or anxiety is there, you know, but later on, it should change into love, in attraction, in desire, in attachment. And this attachment is free of fear. And if the circumstances are fearful, or whatever, positive or negative, you always feel connected with Krishna and not influenced by the gunas and by the circumstances. That's actually a sign of transcendental consciousness. And fear and anxieties and attachments as material things will loosen, go away gradually more and more. And the more they actually become detached and attached instead to Krishna, then the more actually that is considered progressed or advanced in spiritual life or in Krishna consciousness. Okay, stop here, huh? Because it's Arctic now.
Questions? Some questions?
Questions? Questione? Frage? Otherwise, I'll tell you another short story.
Short story.
No, tell. Come.
I will ask in Croatian.
Okay.
Sad smo čuli od njegove svetosti Krishna Kshetra Swami.
We have heard from His Holiness Krishna Kshetra Swami.
Znači, Četvrdarpa na Lađan Lađan je zapravo drugi stih Šikšaštake, Nana Makari Bahuni.
Second verse of Šikšaštaka.
I kaže da nema strogih pravila
pjevati.
Kao nema strogih pravila za pjevanje.
There is stated that there are no strict rules for chanting.
Yeah. A onda kao u ugovoru, u osiguranju sitnim slovima, stoji 10 ugreda.
But in insurance contract, it's written that there are 10
fences. Sitnim slovima, kao?
Like in small letters.
Small letters, yeah, it's written there 10 offenses.
Yeah.
A onda smo kasnije komentirali, tako bili su dosta uzvišene Vajšnave koji su imali na svoje loše iskustva.
And we commented with other Vajšnavas, exalted Vajšnavas, who had bad experiences.
Naprimjer, jedna osoba je mantrala 64 kruga.
One person chanted 64 rounds.
I osjećala se tako dobro, čitala Šrimad Bhagavatam.
And he felt so good, he was reading Šrimad Bhagavatam.
I onda, par minuta kasnije, naišla je na jednu situaciju gdje je jako agresivno reagirala, and, nakon svega toga.
And few minutes after that, he was in a situation and he reacted very aggressively.
Nakon 64 kruga.
After reading Srimad Bhagavatam, he acted in that way, aggressive.
Nakon jako puno staža u svjesnosti Krišne.
After so many years in Krishna consciousness.
I dosta zna...
Who had this problem?
Ko ima ne?
Huh?
One person, I don't want to tell now, name. Ali onda je to dosta obeshrabrujuće. Da li tu faktor milosti i tih tadija treba imati većeg efekta na nas da bimo napredovali?
And this is discouraging and she is asking if this
tadija Tulasi Devi kao milost Vajšnava kao
if actually mercy of what is happening
with Jagannath?
Snana Yatra. Snana Yatra.
Snana Yatra is in 2 days,
no? No, it's here
was called. But in Chavanapuri, 2 days.
Yes. And she's asking if actually mercy of Vaishnavas to Lasi Devi Tadiyas, if this is more important.
Yeah, how can I comment? You know, it's just keep going. Let's keep going. Everything is important. It's not that something is more important, something is less important. So chanting is important, but we should not think because I'm chanting 64 rounds now I'm better situated. So I'm perfect now. Because actually still it's not clear that he has a downri. So we still have so many time, you know, so much time, you know, to contemplate and think. And even during the chanting of 64 rounds, if your mind is not really fixed on the holy name, purely, then maybe it becomes more troublesome in the struggle to chant the 64 rounds. So better we stick to the simple formula of Prabhupada, 16 rounds minimum. And increase now because of some idea you have, or somebody maybe put the idea in your mind, but you're actually not ready. It will come naturally.
Because like Nirja, like Kadashi, when you chant much more and like something, not every day, but when are you only focusing in chanting Maha Mantra, and this is very discouraging. Only few minutes, it was some Krishna's experiment. After some minutes, few minutes.
You should follow Prabhupada's program. You chant your 16 rounds, concentrated or unconcentrated, doesn't matter, just chant and try your best. Go on Sankirtan. Do something for the people, to connect them with Krishna, give them prasadam, give them books, give them this knowledge, teach them how to practice Krishna consciousness. And that's for me more powerful, you know. More powerful effect is if you are, that's actually our only chance, you know, if you can inspire others in this process. Then the process becomes more tasteful. Because we are in the Sankirtan age, we're not in the Japa age. Japa is for highly advanced. But for the general mass of devotees and mass of people, Parinam Sankirtan, congregational chanting is more effective.
Should do more festivals.
Happening programs. The devotees come together, chant together, and have kirtan. Like in Russia, now they do. In so many places, also these kirtan days. Come together for 1-2 days and do kirtan together. Just chant. I'll say loud kirtan. And then also hard enough to get the going out. Because that's Lord Chaitanya's program, that's blessed by Lord Chaitanya. And this japa, we are not really connected with Krishna's name and with the Leela pastimes and with his form. And your mind is really pure, purely fixed on it. Then it will not do it on 64 rounds. It's actually very difficult. I will not do that. I will not even try. We should do that what our spiritual master has blessed us. He blessed us for certain processes that we should do. Because from the spiritual master, from your acharya, the power is coming for the execution of the process. But if you invent something and like to increase artificially something, you know, just because you want to get some higher experience, you know, that's a little risky, I think. Maybe more time for chanting, And how say vibration there, how say the energy there is actually encouraging you for it, because you see so many devotees who chant practically all the time. Maybe there I can imagine that you can, you have to live there, but you have to live there for some time and forget this experience of chanting. So Prabhupada blessed us with all programs, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, Pada Sevanam, Archanam, all the nine processes. We should try to complete. That's the best. Of course, even with one you can make become perfect. But the best process is if you can do all nine together. Or at least seven of them. Up to, because maybe friendship with Krishna, full surrender to Krishna, that's already on a little high, a more advanced platform. But the seven actually bring you to that, to Sankhya and Atmanivedana, if you follow the seven. That means Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasanam. This, you can do. At the Spiritual Master already, Prabhupada gave us all this whole program to do this every day. And if you do that, you get a taste in association with the devotees. That's Hadya. So Hadya is included in this process of Shravanam, Kirtanam, it's perfected especially in the association of the devotees. And one of the process is Pada Sevanam. So Pada Sevanam is practically Tatya. Because it's Tulsi worship, because Tulsi is always situated on Lord's lotus feet. So that's Pada Sevanam. To worship the devotees and serve the devotees who are always situated on Krishna's lotus feet, that's Tatya. That's Pada Sevanam. Therefore, it's very risky to neglect the whole process and only fix them if you have opportunity for the whole process, nine or seven, immediately now. You should do that. Of course, then we can do everything nicely. Because it's a variety in it. Yeah, something else? Otherwise, I'll tell you the long story in short. Today, in other many places, there's a festival. It's called the Panihati Festival. So I want to tell you a little about this. Panihati is a festival actually desired or inaugurated by Raghunath Das Goswami, Raghunath at that time, and under the direction of Nityananda Prabhu. So Raghunath Das Goswami was actually the first of the six Goswami who met Lord Chaitanya in his young age. As a teenager. So he went to Shantipur to meet at the darshan of Lord Chaitanya there. And he was the son of a very wealthy zamindar, landlord, land owner. So, but Lord Chaitanya, although he wanted to join Lord Chaitanya sent him back to home. His parents, to serve his parents and help their business and do externally behave like an ordinary person and internally always being absorbed in Radha Krishna. And in this way, very, very soon, your desire goal will be attained. Krishna will connect you and liberate you from your family, material, responsibility. And you will meet me again. So Raghunath, he followed that instruction of Lord Chaitanya and he went home to his parents, who lived in Shaptagram, on the bank of the Ganga. And he tried several times to escape from home. But his parents always tried to bring him back. He was already married with a very beautiful lady. They even thought that they had to maybe keep the son at home, lock him up, so that he will not always try to run away to meet Lord Chaitanya, become a madman. But then the father told, you know, how we can lock our son up, because he has opulence like King Indra. He has a wife who is as beautiful as an angel or an apsara. So if this cannot bind him, how we can bind him by binding him in our home, keeping captured here? So by chance, sometime Nityananda Prabhu with his associates came to the bank of the Ganga in Shaptagram, in the place known as Panihati. He was sitting there on the bank, because Nityananda Prabhu was always in the mood of Balaram and his associates, the Padasha Gopals, headed by Abhiram Thakur and Sundarananda. And he was sitting on the elevated place underneath a tree on the bank of the river. And he always thought, I'm like in this mood, I'm like in Vrindavan. Again, you see, Nityananda, although he was in Bengal with his associates, far away, 1,000 kilometers away from Vrindavan, he always thought, I'm in Vrindavan. This river is Yamuna, these trees is a Banyan tree, is a Bandira tree, and it's like in 5,000 years ago too. So we do the same thing. We want to make a picnic. So Nityananda was hungry, he wanted to have a picnic. Because the feast was actually only in the evening by Raghava Pandit's house, who was in the neighborhood living. So by chance, Raghunath came there. He was very wealthy. He had many servants. And as soon as he arrived there, one of Nityananda's associates told, "Oh, my lord, just see, Prabhu, there is Raghunath coming." And then Nityananda Prabhu, who was in this mood of cowboy boy, called Prabhu, "Hey, thief, come here," and called him a thief. Milk, yogurt, cheap rice, what else? Sugar, ghee, camphor, betel nuts. Like that. So they all brought this big quantity, and also pots, 200 to 400 pots, where all this rice was soaked in yogurt. One part of it was soaked in yogurt, another one in milk. the milk was boiled. And it became it becomes condensed milk. That means condensed milk. It's boiled down, you know, but it becomes essential thick. And then they add sugar and camphor on it and ghee and put this chipped rice in it. So half of the pots was filled with that, and another half was filled with the chipped rice with yogurt and sugar. So then it was all served out. Devotees, more and more people, and even they heard about this festival, they all came. Very soon the whole platform, all the places there were filled with devotees and people who wanted to take part in this picnic on the invitation of Nityananda Prabhu. And even some they had no place, and so they went down to the river, and some they even went to the river itself, and they all can eat condensed milk with rice and yogurt with rice. And Nityananda Prabhu, he was very happy, was very satisfied. In that time, Raghava Pandit came. Oh, Prabhu, I see you already eating here. I'm going to prepare our lunch for you at home. Big feast. Not cheap rice and yogurt and condensed milk. Big opulent feast, you know. With rice, sabji, dal, and so many sweets. Different varieties of sweets. It's waiting for you at home. But Nityananda told, let me eat this here now, because you know I'm a cowherd for you. And these are all my associates here. And my favorite place, you know, is always to have a picnic underneath a tree on the bank of the river. And so that was Nityananda Prabhu's need. Always. Either as Balaram or as Nityananda. But I will come in the evening, and I will take this prasad in your place. So I will come. So then that place also, Nityananda Prabhu, he had the power, you know, to call Lord Chaitanya. Because Raghunath, he was actually the devotee of Lord Chaitanya. He wanted to meet Lord Chaitanya, but he was never fully successful. Therefore, Lord Chaitanya called him, Lord Nityananda called him thief, Chora, because he wanted to go to Lord Chaitanya without my permission, without my blessing. But the process is, without Lord Nityananda's blessing, we cannot attain the mercy of the lotus feet of Lord Chaitanya. Therefore, Raghunath Goswami had to pay this fees. To serve first the Vaishnavas, Nityananda, the very dear associates of Lord Chaitanya, who is actually not different from Lord Chaitanya, his Swarup, and his greatest devotee, and general for spreading love to Krishna everywhere, even to the lowest, and his associates together. So, if you serve them, then you will get blessings. Nityananda Prabhu invited Lord Chaitanya to come, invisible, nobody could see him. And Nityananda took some of the sweet rice from every pot, from every devotee, and he gave to Lord Chaitanya, put it in his mouth. And Lord Chaitanya took from these pots also, put it in the mouth of Nityananda Prabhu. Then both of them, they were sitting underneath the tree on the high platform, and there they were also eating their own four pots full of different kinds of preparations of sweet rice, soaked in yogurt and milk. So miteinander in Yeti's Tower and he wanted to give a blessing to Kapanand. He was very satisfied and he told, so now my dear associates, my dear friends, Kapanand's desire is that he will attain the lotus feet of Lord Chaitanya. Please bless him that he very soon can attain his desired result or wish to attain the lotus feet of Lord Chaitanya in Chapanapuri. And he actually become a servant of Sarvodhammadhar Goswami and become one of the internal associates, most confidential associates, antaranga associates of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Puri. So therefore, by the blessings of Nityananda Prabhu and all his associates, Raghunathas later on became the great Raghunathas Goswami, very confidential servant of Sarvodhammadhar, under whose guidance he was serving Lord Chaitanya in Jagannapuri until the end when Lord Chaitanya left from this world. And then Raghunathas Goswami went to Vrindavan and he established the worship of Radha Giridhari and the worship of Radhakund and Jamakund. He stayed there for a very long time, for over 40 years, 42 years or so, always absorbed in, naturally absorbed in chanting, one like of Ram means like 64 rounds, and also bhajan and offering obeisances to all the pilgrims who came there, circumambulating Radha Kund, Shyama Kund. And he was completely absorbed in his eternal Swarup, in his spiritual form, in his eternal service to Radha Krishna. In the evening, then Nityananda Prabhu also went to the house of Raghava Pandit, where he accepted the feast. There was a big festival going on, Kirtan, big feast. And ultimately, and everyone was happy. So this is the Panihati festival, but in some places the temples are doing this. Like in Atlanta, Chaitanya Maharaj, he always did this Panihati festival, where they prepared so many different kinds of sweet rices, and distributed it to all the people who came, all the devotees. Thousands of devotees, people come to participate in that festival. So that's the story of it. And that's actually happening today in Panihati and in some temples in the world. And Snana Yatra is in Puri on Tuesday. Then Lord Jagannath goes from the altar for 6 weeks this year. 6 weeks. Because this year we have this Purushottama month, extra month. And this extra month is needed because in this year, every 19 years, Lord Jagannath is manifested in a new form. He's made of wood, as you know. But after 19 years, this wood becomes replaced with the new neem trees. And this is called Navakalibra. The last time was 96, and now in 2015. Now this new Jagannath will become manifested, and then the Ratha Yatra will be with. Okay. Okay, Master of Ceremony. What else? Kirtan? Kirtan? Kirtan. Hare Krishna, Lord Prabhupada, Mantra, Siva Pahata, Vijaya.
With grace, the peace of the
Prabhupada.